Wherever there are valuable things, there are going to be forgeries. We're all familiar with tales of counterfeit cash, fine art, designer handbags, and even fake food. We have an episode on that one. This may sound weird, but this affects the paleontology world too. There are plenty of people out there who try to get away with making fake fossils. Turns out, if an ancient bone discovery seems too good to be true, sometimes it is. And counterfeit fossils tend to really gum up the works of this area of research. So let's explore some of the most audacious fossil frauds ever documented and how scientists proved they were fake. Paleontological fraud is surprisingly common, partially because everybody loves a fossil and lots of people are willing to pay for them. For instance, the fossil industry in Morocco alone is worth $40 million a year and employs around 50,000 people. So there's big money in making dupes of all kinds of beloved creatures. Take the humble but beloved trilobite, arthropods that swamped Earth's ancient seas for almost 300 million years. Trilobite fossils are pretty common, so they've become a piece of prehistory the average person can conceivably take home for a relatively low price without worrying about depriving scientists of specimens to study. But the thing is, people want fossils that look really good, and the preservation quality of a long-dead trilobite is often not great. Cut them some slack, they've been buried for hundreds of millions of years. So counterfeiters sometimes just mass produce replica trilobites, passing them off as the real thing. The time-honored tradition of fossil fabrication generally employs one of two methods in their craft. Either you can cobble together complete-looking specimens out of shards of poorly preserved ones, or just carve or cast them out of anything from plaster to high-tech polymers. Some of these forgeries are good enough to outfox the experts, especially when the experts are seeing what they want to see, as was the case with our first example, which led to some truly scandalous 18th century paleo drama. One of the greatest hits of the fossil forgery canon is the tale of the Beringer's Lying Stones, a scandal born of good old-fashioned professional pettiness on one side and some god-level wishful thinking on the other. In the early 1700s, there was this German medical doctor and university professor named Johann Beringer. He achieved a ton of professional success at an early age, to the displeasure of some of his colleagues. Beringer happened to have a special passion for petrifactions, which we now call fossils. And his tendency to ramble on the topic led two of his colleagues to play a trick on him that got a little out of hand. In 1726, Dr. Beringer's young field assistants brought him a few weird-looking rocks they claimed to have found in the shell lime deposits on a nearby mountain. They looked somewhat like fossils, but they were different from those Beringer had seen in the past. They depicted frogs mating, spiders sitting in their webs, birds in flight, and some other pretty whimsical creatures. And he was entirely taken in by the forgeries, even though they are kind of hilariously fake. I mean, look at him. Beringer's assistants continued bringing him fake fossils, which had been carved into the limestone by his two work enemies. Over time, the forgers got a bit cocky and started making the fakes more and more obvious. Some of them depicted comets and stars, and even the name of God in Hebrew. Be that as it may, Beringer was so hornswoggled by the whole charade that he planned to write a book about his findings, which he ended up doing, even though his two work bullies were like, "Johann, they are so clearly fake." And he was like, "You're just keeping me from my well-deserved professional glory." It was awkward. Anyway, the book was published, and Beringer was eventually convinced by all the feedback he received that he had, in fact, been duped. At which point, he sued the guys who tricked him, and the whole debacle was a bit of a mortifying career ruiner for all three of them. So I guess the moral of the story is, don't trust your coworkers? While it might have been easier to pull off a fossil con in the 18th century, and it must be said, Beringer seemed like he was a uniquely gullible guy, fossil fabrications can still deceive the experts, at least temporarily. Although the lore around a fake fossil cheetah skull, published in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in 2008, is not as robust as Beringer's, it certainly embarrassed a fair few paleontologists and a highly reputable peer-reviewed journal. And this skull was a big deal because it seemed to answer a pressing question. Where did the cheetah lineage start? Since it was allegedly found in China and dated to the late Pliocene, it seemed to give researchers a solid answer. So it would have been really cool if the skull wasn't a fake, but it was, and the paper describing it was published in that super prestigious journal. But it turns out the skull was cobbled together from scraps of other bones and sculpted with plaster, which researchers only discovered when another cheetah expert, Tung Tao, studied the photos more closely. By the time the hoax was discovered, the paper had been cited 11 times in other papers, meaning that more research had been built on this shoddy foundation, which is a bummer. But it just goes to show that in science, you can't get away with being a cheetah. So that last example is one where instead of carving out a fake from nothing, a real object was enhanced to make it look even more impressive. Fossil augmentation like that can be done in a variety of ways, and they keep on tricking generation after generation of paleontologists. Take the forgery of Tridentosaurus Antiquis, a fossil of a lizard thought to have lived in what's now the Italian Alps during the Permian period, so 299 to 252 million years ago. Since its discovery in 1931, the lizard has been considered one of the best preserved fossils from the area because it preserved soft tissue in the form of carbonized flakes of skin. Some experts even considered it one of the oldest mummies ever found. However, the taxonomy of the lizard flummoxed researchers for years, so it sat around uninspected by modern imaging techniques for pretty much decades. And when researchers finally got around to scanning it with UV light and doing 3D surface scans, they discovered the skin of the fossil was just a layer of black paint. But again, while that part of the fossil may be fake, it's a real lizard underneath it all. The team that uncovered the paint deception found that the lizard's back leg bones seem to be real, as well as a few osteoderms on the lizard's back. Nobody knows exactly who perpetrated the forgery on this fossil, and since so much time has passed, that will probably remain a mystery. And before we unmask our next fossil fraud, here's a quick ad break. Thanks to Jump for supporting this SciShow video. Jump is a statistical analysis software designed to help you with all kinds of predictive and specialized data modeling, whether you're just getting started or are already an expert. When you have a ton of data with what feels like millions of variables, you could use Jump's predictor screening functionality to highlight the most meaningful variables and avoid wasting time and resources on other ones. And that's the kind of analysis that makes you feel like a real pro. So at that point, you might as well go for Jump's pro features, like spectral analysis and Fourier transformations that let you analyze data in-house. From screening to transformations, Jump has you covered through your whole data analysis process. You can check them out with a 30-day free trial for anyone anywhere at jmp.com/scishow. While the forger who pulled off the lizard ruse was a complete unknown, there are some very famous forgers who were absolute maestros of their craft. One such artiste was an English solicitor and amateur archaeologist named Charles Dawson. He pulled off probably the most impressive forgery of the 20th century, known as the Piltdown Man, which bamboozled experts for half a century. However, Dawson was responsible for quite a few other forgeries that didn't cause quite as much of a stir, but were still pretty remarkable. One of his notable earlier works was The Toad in the Hole. In 1901, Dawson announced his discovery of a mummified toad, which he said he found in a quarry when miners broke open a stone nodule. In his paper where he announced the remarkable find, he speculated that an ancient toad had slipped through a small hole in the rock, but was unable to escape. So, trapped in its stone prison, it survived by feeding on insects that crawled into the hole with it. The fossil was, in fact, a desiccated common toad that was set inside a real stone nodule. However, this story he wove is clearly preposterous, and it's now abundantly clear that he just stuck an old dead toad into a rock and just kind of called it a day. Dawson's overall goal in all these forgeries was to be admitted into the Royal Society. Sadly, he never got in because he died just 4 years after finding the Piltdown Man. And while that particular skull got him international acclaim and is the reason we still know his name today, it clearly wasn't the hole-in-one he'd hoped for. RIP to the greatest one to ever play the game. Dawson's Piltdown Man forgery made him famous because he gave the people what they wanted. Thanks to the 1871 publication of Charles Darwin's Descent of Man, Dawson devoted himself to a life of forgery during a time when the scientific community was hungry for a solid evolutionary connection between humans and apes. And this too is something that others have tried to do in the modern era. Take the Archaeoraptor, a fossil found in China in the late 1990s. This was right around the time that the famous fossil Archaeopteryx had been found, which was one of the first bird-like theropods we'd ever seen. It was major fuel for the idea that dinosaurs were most closely related to birds, which is now super common, but was pretty crazy at the time. And in order to support this idea, researchers wanted more fossils along the line from theropod to Tweety Bird. So when paleontologists saw the photos of this kinda scruffy fossil, they hoped it could be a link between theropod dinosaurs and modern birds. After all, there were obvious bird parts and even feather impressions, but its tail was all dino. Although many paleontologists were suspicious of it from the get-go, enough hype surrounded the specimen that National Geographic ran a feature on it before any scientific consensus was reached about what the heck we were looking at. But as more researchers dug into what they dubbed the Archaeoraptor, things went awry. It turned out that the reason it looked like such a stellar combination of bird and non-flying dinosaur parts is that it was a composite of bird and non-flying dinosaur parts. Whoever created the Frankenfossil cobbled it together out of parts from some shale pits in Liaoning, China. Very soon after the National Geographic article was published, the tail of the fossil was identified as belonging to a dinosaur called a dromaeosaur. The specimen was assembled using the fossil remains of at least two, but possibly as many as five different animals. So this missing link ended up flying the coop. In another installment of paleontologists seeing what they want to see, we have a fake fossil of a Halloween icon, the spider. The Yixian Formation of northeastern China is famous for its beautifully preserved aquatic fossils from the Lower Cretaceous. In 2019, local fossil hunters brought a fossil of a giant spider to a local natural history museum, and scientists there were taken in enough to publish a paper describing the find. For whatever reason, fossil spiders from this region are pretty rare. If I had to guess, it would be because spiders are little and squishable. So when these guys reported that they'd found a spider this old and this, you know, not squished, people were pretty excited. But when you find a super cool specimen, other people are gonna have a look too. And there's always the chance your bubble will burst, which was unfortunately the case with the humongous fossilized spider. When subjected to the scrutiny of fluorescence microscopy, it turned out to be a crayfish that somebody had embellished with painted spider legs. Turns out the ancient Halloween icon was a trick after all. Our final fossil forgery is a story so long and twisty that it spawned multiple conspiracy theories, documentaries, and even a fringe religious group. I give you the man tracks. In the Paluxy River area of central Texas lies a truly wondrous paleontological site on an ancient limestone shoreline. Back in the Cretaceous, a pack of sauropods once trooped across the soft ground, leaving their footprints behind. The region is now famed for the high-quality dinosaur footprints and trackways that are excavated here from all kinds of ancient critters. In the midst of this legacy of dino tracks are some giant human-looking footprints, 38 to 50 centimeters long. If these belonged to an actual person, they would make them about as tall as a standard basketball hoop. They've popped up at various curiosity shops and trading posts over the last 100 years or so, and most people can see at a glance how obviously fake they are. There's even one carved print where a human and dinosaur footprint overlap, which could only happen if the two wandered the exact same mud flat at the exact same time. This one's called the Delk print. Creationists love these man tracks because they suggest that humans and dinosaurs coexisted, meaning that God made every living thing all at once and the dinosaurs just went extinct in the biblical flood. In reality though, these tracks were hand carved into real Cretaceous era limestone by people, most likely during the Great Depression. Did these people have any idea that by carving a bunch of giant human footprints that they'd kick off an anti-science splinter group of fundamentalist Christians? Probably not. But, you know, they were probably just trying to make a buck during the Great Depression, even if the end result was these, not so great depressions. These stories about fossil fraudsters are interesting and sometimes even funny, but at the end of the day, a fake or misleading fossil can sometimes keep us from getting a good picture of the fossil record we have available to us for a very long time. These have done real harm, whether to the research community, the acceptance of evolutionary theory, or even just to some German guy's reputation, which is why it's so satisfying to see these frauds get debunked so we can see where real fossil discoveries can take us.